guys! Ray from Whimsical Pictures here, bringing you my monthly manga pickups for the month of February 2017. Wow, year is already flying by. And I have about 32 books to show you today. Lots of used pickups, but a good size new sustain the industry pile as well. As per usual, we'll be starting with the new books and then moving into the used stuff. So, without further ado, because I don't want this to be too crazy long, we'll start with the new stuff. And the first series is from Dark Horse, and I actually picked this series up from the Right Stuff holiday sale, and then there were a whole bunch of shenanigans, and I had to pick this up from a friend's house, which is why I haven't gotten it until now, but I'm happy to be able to show it to you guys now. I had picked up volumes 2 and 4 of this series used beforehand, so this is just the rest of the series that I didn't already have. And that is volumes 1, 3, and 5 through 7 of Blood Blockade Battlefront by Yasuhiro Naitao. On this volume, I haven't taken the sticker off yet, so as you can see, it's from the creator of Trigun. They really want you to know that. This is basically an action comedy series taking place in a post-apocalyptic version of New York, after the city has been destroyed by a rift to the Alter World opening up in the middle of it, and unleashing hosts of Alter World demons and monsters into the city. And basically in this series, the city has since been rebuilt and renamed Hell Salem's Lot, and this series follows the members of an organization called Libra, that's sort of a secret organization that takes care of Alter Worlder-related problems. And the anime basically just follows, see if I can find a picture of him. Yeah. This kid, Leonardo Watch, and two anime original characters named Black and White, but I was interested to read the manga because it follows, it's basically a series of vignettes following different members of Libra. So I wanted to see some other characters get some focus. Which is definitely the case, and I really appreciate that. We get some stories focusing on KK, on Chain, who is my favorite. I love her. Zap, Zed, Klaus, etc., etc., etc. It's just a really crazy and out there series with a really bizarre sense of humor and lots of over-the-top action, really stylish character designs. The color pages here are garbage. Actually, the release in general is just terrible. Even the cutting is off. That's the biggest problem, is that the cutting is really off. Like, panels and even speech bubbles will be cut in half where they're not supposed to be, which makes it really difficult to follow Naitao's often already difficult to follow artwork. And this is supposed to be sort of a fun, breezy series to read through, so like, not being able to read it properly is kind of an issue. And then you can see how lazy this is from the fact that the attack names, they don't translate the typography. You're supposed to have, like, this impact where you're seeing him prepare for this attack, and then you turn the page and it's like, you see the name being shouted from the high heavens here. But no, if you're an English speaker, you have to zoom in really close, and I don't know if you can even see that, but here's the translation, hugging the kanji, in, like, really lazy type. And it's like, come on, man. You're translating this. You have to actually translate it. I don't want to have to, like, forego the impact of this image and, like, have to squint just to read what's going on. That's not okay. So that's really a shame. And of course, we never got the full series. It's 10 volumes long and we only got 7, but whatever. Enjoyable nonetheless. I'm happy to have it in my collection, even if it's not in the most pristine possible form. Next, from Kodansha, we have a complete series in two omnibus volumes, and that is The Ghost and the Lady from the longer Black Museum series by Kazuhiro Fujita, who is the creator of Ushio and Tora. And this is sort of a supernatural take on the story of Florence Nightingale in Crimea. Here she is right there. And in this version, basically, she is accompanied by a supernatural companion known as the Man in Grey, who is the ghost of a British theater. And I really like Fujita's aesthetic. It's very sort of late 90s shonen. And I don't know, there's something about it that just tickles me. Here's some gross stuff. Oh, boobs. So, this is a really interesting read, translated very well by Zach Davison. They're really high quality releases as well. I basically expected to like this, and I did. So, not much more to say about it than that, but if you would like to see me say more about it, I did wrap it up in one of my weekly manga wrap-ups, so I will link that below in the description box. Next, also from Kodansha, we have Happiness, Volume 3 by Shuzo Oshimi, who is the creator of Flowers of Evil and Inside Mari. So this is a vampire series about this boy Makoto, who gets attacked by a vampire girl in the middle of the night and starts turning into a vampire. And it's really good. This volume in particular has solidified it as a manga that is well worth reading. It's a pretty standard vampire story, and it's covering pretty standard ground for Oshimi. You know, basically vampirism as a metaphor for puberty and sexual awakening, which, definitely not new territory for the author, but he tends to cover those themes very well, and in a very interesting way. And what I really love here is the art. He just takes some serious, like, crazy flights of fancy with his artwork that are just an absolute joy to read through. He experiments with a lot of different styles and really gets across this sort of expressionistic vibe where you really get sort of the feeling of what the characters are feeling and expressing. And yeah, I really recommend this. You also get some really beautiful color pages at the beginning. Next, I think that I have not hauled this yet, but forgive me if I have. This is volume 1 of Miss Kobayashi's Dragon Maid by Cool Kyoshinja. This is the original manga for an anime that I am really, really enjoying right now. Do recommend. It's not a genre I'm typically into, sort of monster girl ecchi comedy thing. But this is so charming. It's about this, like, super boring salary woman, Miss Kobayashi, who basically gets super wasted and wanders into the woods and happens upon a dragon named Toru. And Toru is like, I have nowhere to go. Where can I go? And Miss Kobayashi's, of course, super wasted. She's like, oh man, you should come to my place. Yeah. And so the next day, this dragon in human form, Toru, shows up at her door and says, I'll be your maid. Because apparently Miss Kobayashi, in her drunken stupor, also let it slip that she has a bit of a maid fetish. And Miss Kobayashi, or not Miss Kobayashi, but Toru, has decided that she is madly in love with Miss Kobayashi and wants to live with her for the rest of her days. So... yeah, the rest of it is just about that whole setup. Eventually, our two adorable girlfriends get to adopt an adorable dragon child named Kana, who is the sweetest thing on the planet. And it's just, you know, hijinks ensuing. And it's so cute. It's so cute and funny and quirky and weird. And it's about lesbian dragons, which is amazing. The next pickup is also from Seven Seas, and also about lesbians, because I am a predictable son of a bitch. And this is Secret of the Princess by Milk Morinaga, who I already love. She has had three other series released in English to date. Gakuen Polizzi, which was and Girlfriends and Kisses, Sighs, and Cherry Blossom Pink. Both of those I really enjoyed. So I was looking forward to getting this. She's going to have another release coming out later this year. And this is a one-shot volume, and I loved it. This is easily my favorite Morinaga title to get in English so far. It's about this girl here, whose mom basically always raised her like, you know, a woman has to be good at cooking and cleaning and looking cute so that one day she can get like a rich, handsome husband. But she's struggling to reconcile that with the fact that she's never really been into guys. And meanwhile, she can't seem to get this volleyball-playing tomboy from her school out of her head. And so it's about, you know, the adorable budding romance between these two. And it's short and sweet and well-developed. It's just so nice. It's so nice and well-written and cute. And I think it would be a great introduction to Yuri if you're looking to get into it, especially because it is only one volume long. And yeah, I liked this a lot. Next, from Vertical, we have Volume 5 of Devil's Line. This is another vampire story about this half-devil, Anzai here. Devils are what vampires are called in this series. And he works for a sort of squadron of the police that specifically deals with devil-related crimes. And it's about the stuff that his squadron is dealing with, including, like, a anti-devil terrorist organization, and the budding romance between Anzai and a human girl named Tsukasa, who this card at the end of this volume says is from Kagawa Prefecture, which means that I love her 8 billion times more than I did before, because Kagawa is where I studied abroad, in case you didn't know that. And it's way out in the boonies and never gets any love in Japanese media, so whenever someone is from Kagawa, I have to love them because they are repping an amazing prefecture. But this continues to be a really great series. I wasn't expecting much from it when I picked up Volume 1, but I just love it more and more every volume. The pacing is amazing between these really great, well-crafted human moments between the characters and these more, like, you know, heart-pounding action sequences. It's just a good series. It's a good series. Do recommend. Next, also from Vertical, we have the one-shot volume The God's Lie by Kaori Ozaki, and I got this because of actually a used pickup I'll talk to you about in a little bit, but this one-shot volume is basically the story of these two kids and the summer that they spend together and them dealing with feelings of loss and abandonment and coming of age. And usually I have high expectations for Vertical one-shots. I love, like, Helter Skelter, Utsubora, what else have they released? They've released a lot of really great one-shot volumes, and so I had high expectations for this, but ultimately it was okay. It's just not that interesting, not that unique, not that deep. So I didn't, like, dislike the act of reading it, but I probably will be getting rid of it pretty soon. Especially because my volume is kind of misprinted, and that kind of irritates me just a little bit. It just bugs me when it's on the shelf. But yeah, oh well, they can't all be winners. Next, we have a definite winner, which is Tokyo Ghoul Volume 11. This cover is crazy. I love it. And it's a wraparound. We're getting close to the end here. This series is 14 volumes long, and then we'll get into Tokyo Ghoul Re. But this is the first volume of the series that I actually rated 5 stars. I just loved every page of it. This is absolutely fantastic. I can't really tell you much about what goes on because pretty much everything at this point is spoiler content, but this, I love Tokyo Ghoul, and this volume exemplifies why. Finally, for new stuff, we have Volume 4 of Yona of the Dawn. Once again, I have given detailed thoughts on this volume in one of my weekly manga wrap-ups, so I will link that below. But this is one of my favorite shoujo series coming out right now. I loved the anime, and I am loving the manga just as much. So yeah, it definitely has a retro vibe. It really feels like the epic shoujo fantasy adventure stories that were popular in the 90s, like Basara and From Far Away and Fushigi Yugi and the 12 Kingdoms. So if you like any of those, definitely check this out. It's probably a good place to start if you don't like shoujo that much or haven't tried much, because it does have more of a focus on action and adventure and fantasy than romance, which it doesn't have much of a focus on romance at all, so yeah. Now, let's try to zoom through these used pickups. It's really just a few series. It's just a lot of volumes of a few series. The first one, though, is a one-shot from Blue. This is adding to my Fumi Yoshinaga collection, and it is her collection of BL short stories, Truly Kindly. This was okay. It kind of goes from worst story to best story in my book, and I really hated, like, the first two or three stories, and then I really enjoyed the last few, so kind of a mixed bag. Again, if you want my detailed thoughts, I will link the video where I talk about it in detail below. But yeah, I mean, if you're looking for a good BL volume, you probably can't go wrong with Fumi Yoshinaga. This is better than most of the stuff out there, so yeah. Next, we have another volume of short stories. This was a really interesting find. It is from Kokoro Books, which is a publisher I had never heard of before. But this is called Skin and Bone, and it says Hino Horror 14, so apparently there was a lot of these. But it's a collection of short stories by horror mangaka Hideshi Hino. His stories are really gross and disgusting and stomach-churning, which sometimes I am in the mood for. So I decided to pick this up, because it was kind of a cool find. So yeah. Next, also adding to my Fumi Yoshinaga collection, these were a great find. This is, I think there's 4 volumes in this series, and I found the first 3 of Antique Bakery, which I have read before from the library, and it's a really charming series. A foodie manga about these 3 guys who run a bakery, and if you look here, these are actually scratch and sniff covers. Isn't that a funny little gimmick? But I found the first 3 volumes, and I'm very happy to have found them because this series is funny and sort of down to earth. Lots of delicious looking sweets and lots of really human character moments. Next, we have volumes 1-7 of a series by Kaori Ozaki, which is why I ended up picking The God's Lie, because I have been enjoying this immensely. And that is Immortal Rain. This is the story of this girl, Machika, a self-proclaimed assassin whose goal in life is to be the one who finally kills the fabled immortal Methuselah, whose real name is Rain. This is him. And who has eluded capture for centuries. 6 centuries, actually. He's 600 years old. And of course it gets more complicated than that, as we realize the reason for his immortality and why the world is kind of a wasteland and everything. But I've just really been enjoying this. It's a really solidly crafted shoujo sci-fi adventure story with a likable heroine and a likable main romance. And yeah, I recommend it. This is my favorite cover because it's cute. Two more series to go through. This one I think I'll save for last. So, from Viz, we have volumes 2 through 5 of a series that I halt the first volume of last time, and that is W. Juliet. Unfortunately, I probably won't be keeping these very long, because I didn't enjoy them very much. I really wanted to love this series because of the fun gender-bending premise, and how super cute and adorable the tomboy heroine is. But unfortunately, it's just really pretty generic. The humor's just okay, and there's a lot of uncomfortable gender stuff that I was hoping wouldn't be there. So, you know, maybe not so much for me, but that's okay. And finally, a very fun pickup from yesterday. I am almost done with the first volume. These are omnibuses, but this is The Drops of God by Tadashi Agi and Shu Okimoto. And if you know me in real life at all, you probably know that I am a huge wino. I love wine, so this series I'm pretty sure was made specifically for me. It's a seinen foodie manga about wine, and it's about this kid who is the son of a famous wine critic, but he has never tasted wine. In fact, he works for a beer company. But after his dad's sudden death, he basically has to go on this quest that his dad is sending him on to identify 12 amazing god-tier wines so that he can get his dad's inheritance. And yeah, it's basically all about learning about wine, and you know, it's got a lot of like affordable alternatives to super fancy wines, which is very interesting to me. And I am really enjoying it. As I said, I'm almost through the first volume, and yeah. Only a few volumes of this were ever released in English. It is very long-running in Japan, but I think I'm okay with that because it is quite episodic. So, yeah. Definitely recommend this if you're into, like, foodie manga, or if you're like me and you love wine. This was great. It's an older vertical release. And yeah, that is everything that I got for the month of February. Hope you guys enjoyed. Let me know in the comments what you picked up this week. This month. Let me know what you picked up this month. Let me know if any of the titles I talked about interest you, if you've read any of them. And if you liked the video, go ahead and like and subscribe. See you next month, and happy reading!